Welcome back to Let's Play Torment Tides of Numenera Blind. I'm the RPG chick. We are about to enter the Sorrow's Fathom to do this, the Infestation quest. Fragments left behind by the Sorrow's incursion have wormed their way deep into the labyrinth. Like plagues in my mind, they are stunting my potential. Enter the infested Fathom. A new portal in the calm leads to the Fathom the Sorrow's fragments have infested. I must destroy or contain them if I hope to rid myself of the Sorrow's interference in my mind. Let's do it.
All right.
I'm glad you agree. Let's hope we're powerful enough to do this. As your body pours from the portal, an ad hoc laboratory comes into view. Irregular catwalks connect several platforms, each littered with dusty machines, tools, and displays. In the center of each fathom stands a strong glass tank, glowing like the orbs from the dark fathom you were born in. You have a feeling that, like the orbs, those tanks contain your memories. Each tank is connected to a machine on the same platform. Okay. Caustic black ichor sputters from all but the nearest of the glowing tanks, keeping you from seeing or even feeling what lies inside. The oily film on a distant machine pauses, almost as if it has noticed your presence. It begins to drain from the device. As the black sludge coalesces, you recognize it as a fragment of the Sorrow, stronger from feeding on your subconscious all this time. Because the fragments have been feeding on your tidal energy, you sense that they are bound to you, at least for now. You may be able to use the machines in this place to manipulate them. A mental reflex twitches, a subconscious response to the perceived threat, calling forth reflections of your current companions. Oh, sweet. Call the reflections to aid you. Yes. My friends.
Friendly little thing, isn't it?
Now, it's not truly them, it's reflections, right? Trap or kill the Sorrow fragments infesting the Fathom. Use the lab machines to track and ensnare the creature. 3 Sorrow fragments remaining. Sorrow's Fathom. Okay, so I guess these are all my machines. I got 2 here, 1 here, and 1 here. I don't know what these green things are. I can't mess with the green things. The Sorrow's fragments emit a psychic static, disrupting your ability to understand what the flickering holograms from this machine are trying to convey. This device wafts a mild fog filled with scents that tickle your memory, but the Sorrow's fragment radiates a sharp ozone stench, disrupting your thoughts. I'm just going to look at everything that needs to be looked at, or that can be looked at. This device ticks and whirs, and each tick calls out to a part of your mind, but the Sorrow's fragments intercept the call, and you are unable to interact with the machine. So these are just the ones we cannot interact with. So there's a Sorrow fragment. The distortions and disruptions caused by the Sorrow fragments' presence keep you from interacting with the machine. The memories the machine tries to summon darken and tear, disrupting by the Sorrow's fragment in a device. These look remarkably like the resonance chamber. This laboratory must have been constructed from memories of your sire's first experiments with it. Okay. So we can interact with... Who's going? I guess we all have the ability to interact with these. So I'll send Tyvir.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Did that do anything? Is there one there? We only have 1 Sorrow right now, but it says there's 3. Oh, so Tyvir... Oh, he went through that. Can he go through it again? I guess it should be near what we're trying to do. So, like, we want to interact with that then. Doesn't look like I can do this again. I'm gonna just keep him there in case. Eritus. Can Eritus interact? To interaction! Judging by the images and information flitting across the display, it is some sort of control mechanism for the tank on this platform. Pictograms flicker across the flat surface on the device, the information and options changing before your eyes. It is responding to your thoughts as you seek a way to dispatch the sorrow fragments. I don't have any actions left, so I can't do anything. The last cast-off's turn, which is me, naturally. I can't interact with that. I can't make my way that far. That's retreating. Back to the calm. Don't want to do that. So what's actually the closest thing I can interact with besides this? Which is just a tunnel. Not really anything. Unless I want to go over here.
Of course.
There's going to be two more, so I might as well just try to get some things ready. The screen flashes angrily. Foreign body present in tidal flow regulators. Configure flush. It must be talking about the fragment feeding on the tank. Oh, there's a fragment there. Unfortunately, I can't do anything yet. Calistige. Ditto for this one?
Allow me.
The stuttery voices. Same. Oh, I can consume an action. Flush the system just enough to remove the sorrow fragment. 85%. Success! The machine floods with power. The air around it crackles as eldritch energy pours through the tank. The sorrow fragment spills from the device, taking form with a head-splitting screech. Did I want to do that? Now I gotta deal with it. Owie. What about this thing? Does it have to be near what we're working with? That's probably a tunnel through there, and vice versa. Let me try going here and see what this might do, since he's close enough to do something. Pictograms flicker across the flat surface on the device, the information and options changing before your eyes. It's responding to your thoughts as you seek a way to dispatch the sorrow fragments. I think that might be identical to what I just read. Okay. Cause energy to leak from the tank, attracting the fragments. Right, and then we can do that. Charge the tidal pulse. Tidal fumes spill from the projector, sizzling and evaporating like water on a hot pan as it spreads across the floor. The sorrow's fragments turn toward the platform. They're gonna go over there now. Eritus gets to go. Okay. Begin charging a tidal pulse to paralyze nearby fragments. The roiling energies in the tank begin to slow and move in unison, coalescing into a visibly ordered pattern as the machine indicates a buildup of energy. It indicates that a paralyzing pulse will detonate before your next action. Cool. Hopefully it'll do it before the sorrow fragment's next action. Okay, Eritus is done then. Okay, flush the system just enough to remove the sorrow fragment. Do it. I'd say just 95%. Same. You get out of there.
Right.
So then we can paralyze nearby ones. Okay. So I'm just gonna stay there. Paralyze nearby fragments. Well, at least it missed. Ow. She's hurting. I got a critical hit, damn it. One's paralyzed? There's only three, right? So I might as well just return that one to normal. Now the resonance chambers we can't do anything with. I guess paralyzing them is good enough. We also have that one, which I assume serves the same. This is a tunnel type thing, wormhole. So I can get all the touchy things. This looks similar to the others. The tanks, that is. Okay. Once we paralyze them, then what? We know what to do next. I'm just gonna have him stand by here.
Something to do.
The machine no longer functions. All of its energy seems to have gone toward the pulse that affected this platform. All right. It's paralyzed, I guess, for good? And I can't interact with it.
Want a job done right.
Yeah, no. I'm gonna run him over here. Check out that tank. Didn't I do this already?
Yes, now.
Okay. I guess I didn't. Oh, look at that thing. This thing's come to life. This device emits a scented fog, but you can't get closer to engage with it while the Sorrow's fragments prowl the area. So if you paralyze them all, then I can work with these things. Oh, there's like somebody in there. Okay, I'm gonna stay there. I think then we're going to interact with these things after. So I'm going to keep her there. Ah, God. Passing. gonna just have him on standby there. With the last of the sorrow fragments neutralized, you feel a cool breeze flow through you. Mind and body. Like a clarity spell from EverQuest. Your muscles tense with dexterity and strength you haven't felt before. My intelligence went up. Oh my. Intellect, like my max intellect is 24 now. And was my speed that high before? I think my speed was 13. So I think my speed and my intellect went up, I think. Your muscles tense with dexterity and strength you haven't felt before. I guess maybe my might went up as well. I'm not sure. And your mind flows gracefully from thought to thought, exploring possibilities and sensations more quickly than ever before. Gradually, you become aware of a shadow in your mind. The sorrow still has one stronghold somewhere in the labyrinth. You've almost driven it out entirely, but not yet. Now what do we do?
Yes.
A low aromatic fog surrounds this device, and every whiff of the vapor conjures up a memory from deep within you. The cheering throng that spreads before you across Government Square has a voice like thunder, rolling and booming through the city. The people in it are victims, survivors, victors, and the last of their enemies kneels before you on the broad steps. You hold your hands aloft for silence. The thunder subsides to a low murmur and becomes a quiet, hungry wait. They want to see vengeance. And so do you. Oh, the ache is so strong. Ogesti, tel kotu, you proclaim. Orphan maker, hope smasher. The crowd seethes at his titles. Today is the day of your judgment, you roar. Today is the day that the bot pay in full for the crimes against our citizens, against humanity everywhere. Today sees an end at last to the Tabat. The crowd erupts in frenzied joy. You lean forward and whisper in his ears. You have two choices, a quick death or an immortality for which you sacrifice your ambition and your freedom. That's the guy in... Well, he's not in Government Square. He's in the, the first area of Sega's Cliffs that we come through. I forget the name. It's been so long since I've been there. But yeah, he chose to have immortality. And so he stands there. He cannot move. He can't do anything to anybody. But the bot stares at you, his strange eyes wide. Why? Because one choice will end your subjugation. Here. Now. Cleanly. The other will give you immortality, but by imprisoning you in time. But consider, one day I might die, and on that day, you'll still be here. I am giving you a gift, if you can master it, a victory, but only if you can learn the deadly art of patience. The Tabat scowls, sensing some trick. You touch him with your mind to shove him over the edge of desire. He winces as the ripple of your psyche washes over him. He rumbles, death holds no fear, but I will tell the future how I bested you. You smile as you turn away, signaling for the machines that will enslave him to your will. Then you pause. He was a notable foe. Perhaps he deserved better than to be a permanent marker to your triumph. You owed him the right to make his own choices, you think. Then you remember the faces of the sickened and dying. You inject him yourself. Cool. Okay, that's him. Him and Changing God.
Yes.
The aromas that drift from the device no longer have an imperative hold on your mind. Okay, what about this one?
All right.
This little device issues a series of ticks and clicks, and each one calls to a different part of your mind. You feel a memory coming. You're lost in the scent of her hair, the taste of her mouth, the feel of her skin. You stumble against the door and fumble with the lock, unwilling to break contact with this remarkable, beautiful, wonderful woman. Even before you manage to wrestle the door open, you're already shrugging out of your clothes. Once inside, the rest of your clothes disappear as if by magic. The city outside is noisy, But you can't hear the din of the market as you focus on her breath, her eyes, her body, and the day vanishes like your clothes. Eventually, hours later, night falls, and the two of you collapse onto the ruined bed. She drifts off to sleep, whispering in your ear of what you could accomplish together. As her contented breathing warms your chest, you reflect. You never expected Salamary to be like this when you sought her out. Salamary. God, I gotta remember who that is now. Salamary. Wasn't she in the Fifth Eye Tavern? I'm not sure. You intended only to take advantage of her position and her expertise, but she has become so much more in such a short time. She makes you reconsider everything you've been striving forward toward for all these years. Gods, you don't remember feeling love like this for anyone since... No. No. Another memory swells, and it reminds you of your goal. What you want in this moment can't distract you from the centuries you have spent building this life. You stroke Salamary's hair, and the tides trickle from you into her dreams. You break her love from you, turning it back to the work you discussed. You refocus her mind and rebuild her affection. You don't want to lose this, but you can't cast off your ambition. You lie in bed, waiting for her to wake, for the work to start again. A single tear dwells in your eye. You dash it away. What work? I must know more. The device continues to click, but the pull on your memory is gone. Something tells me deal with that one last, because it's in the center of the room, I guess.
Yes, now.
No trip now. The machine projects a looping holographic scene. As you study it, you briefly feel it probe your mind, and then an onrushing wave of artificial nostalgia as it summons memories. You have been walking under the wasted sun for what feels like days. The sun does not move on the horizon, and its incessant heat has scoured the plane of life. Your water is running low, and you're seriously considering abandoning its body. And then you see shapes shimmering on the horizon. You release an eye catcher. It will tell you if this is a mirage or a destination. It shoots into the sky, vanishing from sight. It returns with good news. You've discovered an oasis. Of sorts. You trudge onward, bitterly wishing for better boots. When at last you reach the rude collection of wattle and daub huts, primitive humans gathering around you, beseeching you in a strange tongue. They offer you some of their precious remaining water, and you settle down to learn the basics of their language. After a day, you know enough to understand the depth of their plight. They say the lurker in the cave has stolen the sun's momentum. They beg for your aid. After a fitful nap, you begin the perilous climb to the cave. Inside, a long-forgotten installation houses a trapped construct. It speaks through the scree of a fallen ceiling, and it tells you that it has demanded the autocatons clear the rubble. When they refused to dig it free so it could return to its work, it sealed the plane inside a time bubble. They will come to reason, it concludes. You don't have time for this. The construct's needs are paltry, compared to the need for water, sorry. You concentrate, marshaling your powers, the tides you have been researching. You imagine them as a blade, and you hurl them against the construct's circuitry. The machine struggles, throwing up defenses against you, but it is no match for this raw energy. Sorry, this new energy. It fizzles and dies, and you feel a wrench as time lurches back into motion. You look at your hands, the flesh hangs loose on your suddenly skeletal frame. A steep price to protect these villagers. Well, this is all the changing god? Well, he did good here.
Right.
The holographic loop continues, but the itch to delve into a memory is gone. Now,
I'm going.
What if I mess with this thing now? With no present threat, the machine hums idly. It offers no way for you to interact with it. Alright, what if I go through this thing?
Yes.
Then I go through it. cool.
On it.
Okay, this one.
All right.
A single figure inside. As you inspect this device, you feel it rifling through your mind, bringing up a blur of unbidden images. One of them in particular demands your attention, tugging insistently at a buried memory. You enter the tavern and every face turns to you. The warm susurrus of conversation trails off. They know you, and they know what you've come here for. The Aldea of Thal supports the nearby clave, and the locals keep a chary eye on the Aeon priests. They know the dangers of the Numenera the scientists unearth, and, given their proximity to the endless battle, they know what your tattoo means. You hear the sharp whisper, "Cast off, scum!" You don't give them the satisfaction of looking. But you can feel the tension in the room as you make your way up to the bar. The tavern keeper won't meet your eye. You know what comes next. You sigh and turn to face the room. A large, burly woman stands in front of you. "You're not welcome here, Cast-Off. Your damn war is a bane. We'll have no Cast-Offs here. Not anymore. Get out, or by the gods we'll make you wish you had." Guess what? We're going to use the tides. Yep. You feel energies building and swirling within you. Your smile is savage as you weave a net of the tides. You have no idea who you're talking to. "I am no Cast-Off. I am their creator. I am the author of the endless battle. I am the changing god, and you will revere me." You hold your hands wide, and the tides spill from you. Half the villagers fall to their knees, weeping as your will twists their hatred into adoration. The burly woman yanks a knife from her belt. "You'll not take my mind, monster." Her neighbors fall on her before she can take another step, knives flashing. Her life spills across the floor, around your feet. You step through it, trailing bloody footprints to the door, and you're not sure if the disgust you feel is for the dead woman or for yourself.
Yes, now.
The machine conjures up the images in your mind again, a kaleidoscope of reclaimed memories, but the urge to explore them has vanished. Okay. Next. Resonance chamber. Okay. So there's only one thing we haven't interacted with, and that's this blue one in the center. We got a very tall man and someone very short next to him. He's either pushing him holding up a hand towards him. I can't tell which way the short figure is standing. But the tall one's definitely facing towards the short one.
Let's go.
Let's go. Images flicker in the air, projected from this machine, reliving the same scene over and over again. As you study the device, you feel it reaching into your mind, pulling memories to the surface. You are watching a display cast through crystal prisms. The images and the colors are a jagged rainbow, just as they have been in every previous iteration of this machine, when they should be a single glowing picture. At least if this device is to function as intended. You hiss through your teeth in frustration. How many years must you waste in trying to align these energies? Is the effort fruitless? "Turn it off," you snarl. Your apprentice pays you no heed. Crystal prisms. We're inside the crystal cavern, aren't we? And that's the one we found? The logs? I think? Well, the logs were a cast-off. So it's not his apprentice, but somebody that he was inhabiting and left behind. "A moment longer," he murmurs. "Just a moment." He is kneeling before the control panel and reaches in to make a slight adjustment. Above him, the images and the colors align. He sits back on his haunches, an enormous grin wreathing his face. "I knew it! I could hear it whispering to me. It's like it wants to be done. This is my masterpiece. Now what's the next step?" You're not sure if your cast-off prodigy is talking to you or the machine. You stare at the back of his head. He's undeniably gifted. In certain aspects, you have to admit, he even surpasses you. This is, after all, part of why you constructed his body the way you did. But now that he's achieved this, do you dare to let him return to the world? He knows your deepest secret now, and holds your future in his hands. But you feel a certain affection for him. To kill him would be poor thanks indeed. Instead, you speak. Mazov. Oh, it's Mazov, you whisper. He turns around, and the instant he makes eye contact, the full force of your psychic power crashes through his meager defenses. You insinuate yourself into his memories and erase the details of this last year of work. It's a crude tool, a bludgeon, but you tell yourself it's kinder than destroying him. You almost believe it. So that's what happened to Mazov. The images continue to display, but the nagging itch of memory has disappeared. Very interesting. Oh, my little friend images have left. Alright. Nothing else to do now, right? Just to go. Okay. We shall go.
Ready.
So we have to go fight the Sorrow again in another labyrinth. Quest is gone. This thing's still here. Must be a bug. We're way past that. So yeah, I don't have a quest right now to mess with the Sorrow Fragments even more. That's back to the main world. That's the Clock Fathom and Daughter's Fathom. Those have already always been there. Well, not always, but they're not new. That's what I'm trying to say. I keep checking her. Now let's return.
Fine. Much better.
We got torn apart by, I don't know, little furry fuzzy creatures.
You're back! Adventure awaits! Somewhere!
Yeah. Slimy, icky adventure. Well, that's where the whirlpool is. Is this where we were? Guys are fighting again. C01. Well, at least we're back. I'm back to full strength. I'm down with speed and intellect. That's only because my speed increased, I believe. And my intellect is, you know, just, I only used a few points. So we're fine. We actually don't need to rest. It was you guys' images that helped me. Not them themselves. If that makes any sense. But I'm pretty sure this is not where we were in the bloom. We're still in the gullet. I think maybe we were over there. I'm not sure. In any case, I think we want to stay away from this whirlpool and not mess with it. The more we look at it, the more we're drawn in. So, In any case, thanks so much for watching, guys. Stay tuned for the next episode when we explore more of the gullet. And I'm going to look at that candy dispenser thing then, too. Thanks for watching. See you next time. And endure. And enduring? Go strong.